I started here at SFGH at the end of my fellowship at UCSF in oncology and cancer medicine. And the first day on the job, July 1st, 1981, I saw the first patient with Kaposi sarcoma who had just been admitted to the hospital. He was the first Kaposi's patient, AIDS patient, who was admitted here at the General. And seemed interesting. I was a brand new oncologist, so it was appropriate that I would be involved in his care. And in the course of that, realized that we were just beginning to see the beginnings of what became this massive epidemic.
San Francisco General Hospital has a specialized unit specifically for the care and treatment of patients with AIDS.
And what kinds of things do you see among the sickest patients in the patient?
Well, we see it so often in the outpatient clinic. We get to know new patients. A patient comes. Often the patient is young. Often the patient now, as I get older, the patient's younger than I am. Younger than the doctors and nurses in the clinic. We see people who go from being very intelligent, conversant, friendly people to being shells of humans. People that become more and more demented. People who feel unable to go out in public. The stigma that they feel and the fingers pointing and the glances in public. In any number of ways, this is just a horrible situation.
The number of patients that were seen here at the hospital increased, not explosively at first, but steadily. Each one was complicated, each one was unique, and all of the early patients with AIDS died. I worked very closely with a physician, Connie Wofsy, who was very interested in the infections that we were seeing. I was interested especially in the cancers that we were seeing. We gradually grew the program. On January 1st, 1983, the numbers of patients had increased to the point where the hospital found us new space, unused space in one of the old red brick buildings here at the hospital, building number 80, and it was on the sixth floor, so it was called Ward 86. Friends that I had in training sort of avoided me, sort of jokingly avoided shaking hands and things like that. But it wasn't really a joke. They were afraid. And I think the fact that a number of us decided actively to be involved in this care, even though the patients that we were treating, gay men, injection drug users, were certainly not popular in the medical world, added some to our stigma, but I think it made us also a little bit proud. We participated in a lot of the research and we helped educate doctors and others about this disease. But I think probably the single thing that I'm happiest about in retrospect was helping create community-wide, hospital-wide, university-wide approach that reflected the real needs of our patients. Rather than having the patients have to search out who is the psychiatrist who can help me, who is the dentist that can help me, all of that, to bring it together in one place was pretty remarkable. And it was that model called the San Francisco model, or the San Francisco General model, as I preferred to call it actually, that was really looked at around the world. We were really at the forefront of what became called translational research, where you can translate basic laboratory observations into day-to-day patient care, and then turn that around and help the laboratory scientists better understand what they should be looking for next. So it was a totally exciting development, and one that really continues to this day.
I think we have some very optimistic things to talk about. We have seen the survival prolonging in patients. We've seen a more developed understanding of the nature of the disease, and I think we're at the verge, really, of having much more to talk about in terms of effective therapies. Our goal is to make this a chronic, controllable disease.
the job for us, at first at least, was a lot easier than for some cities. San Francisco is a geographically very small place. It's a seven by seven miles and has one academic medical institution, the University of California. It has a history of a strong public health department. And then the obviously important issue of a very mobilized, politically potent, and out gay community. And so when this became clear that it was going to be an increasing problem in the homosexual community, that community was able to pressure us, the city, to make sure that the services were in place. Having participated in seeing the early epidemic, being there when treatments got, for the first time, more effective, I've also had the great fortune of being able to watch, just in the last few months, the results of trials where people getting an injection of long-acting drug, not three drugs now, but one really powerful drug, given as an injection every 6 months, are able to not only control the virus, but to prevent them from getting infected. I would say, and I've had the chance to see, this is like bookends, right? Maybe more than two bookends, but the start of the epidemic, effective treatment, and then amazingly effective prevention. And so, you know, I won't be around forever, but I think I can anticipate that the world is going to conquer this disease, that we're going to be able to stop HIV.